yeah, Uncle Ralph, you already know what it is. You know what you're doing. Video Music Box, I'm here. Real fans, real talk. And that's the way it's going down. Don't go nowhere. Fix your face. They ain't going nowhere. Ha.
Face facts, what up?
Real fans, realtalk.com. Where Arthur Domus, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Real fans, realtalk.com, got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Is Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log on to the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor, tell them Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter, tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified cosign, you know what I'm about, son. Real fans, realtalk.com. I'm out, one. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, realtalk.com. Real fans, realtalk.com. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, realtalk.com. Real fans, realtalk.com.
What's going on, family? Welcome back to another live episode of Real Fans Real Talk. We got a whole lot of sports to get into. It's been a great week, especially in football, because those New York football giants are still in first place. But I ain't even going to get too excited right now. Let me introduce my co-host, the one and only Mark the Statman Skevich. What's going on?
What's going on, ladies and gentlemen? Great to be back for another live episode of Real Fans Real Talk. As you said, the New York football giants are in first place, so I'm a happy camper as well.
Wait, so it's not the Cowgirls or the Eagles?
It's not the Cowgirls or the Eagles.
You
or
sure?
The Redskins. I am
Check 100% the stats on that stat,
positive.
Man. Check the stats.
Yep, I checked my watch.
Somehow, okay, all right, cool, cool. That worked. I'll tell you, I'll take that.
What time is it? Yeah, no, last time I checked, they were in first place.
Just wanted to make sure, that's all.
Also, shout out to the Brooklyn Mariners, my semi-pro football team. We are in the playoffs. We had a first week bye. We won the conference semifinals this past weekend. We are in the conference championships this Saturday, 7 p.m. in Staten Island. For those of you in Staten Island who want to make the trip out there, it's Corporal Thompson Park. At 7 p.m. this Saturday, it's on Broadway, Corporal Thompson Park in Staten Island, 7 p.m. conference championships. Then 2 weeks later, we'll be playing for the championship. So I'm a little excited about that as well, Tripp.
Well, hold up, because my Pee Wee football team didn't advance in the playoffs right now, too. So they one win away from the Super Bowl in Pee Wee football out of Long Island. Let me shout out to Glen Cove Cardinals then.
There
we out here shouting out football teams.
Two wins away from the so-called MLF Super Bowl. They don't call it the Super Bowl, but regardless, excited about that. Excited for the Glen Cove Cardinals as well. But the main story in New York right now is the artist formerly known as Snuffleupagus. Trip Young
used to call... favorite player in the league right now.
Kristaps Porzingis. He's been playing well. He shows that he's clutch, but a millisecond too late. And if you guys saw the replay footage, you would see we got a photo of that as well. If you guys look at it, it's, you know, obviously the clock is all zeros. The backboard there is red, and it is still in his hands. They were down by two on the road against the Charlotte Hornets, and that would have been the game winner. In full speed, everyone, including myself, thought it was good. But obviously in the replay, it doesn't even seem like a tenth of a second, maybe, two hundredths of a second or something like that. It literally left his fingertip right after that.
You know what, Statman, that really just sums up those New York Knickerbockers, a day late and a dollar short.
I mean,
it was my man Porzingis. So look, I'm not calling him Snuffleupagus anymore, at least. So he has that going for him, right?
Yeah, he's just the artist formerly known
as Snuffleupagus. Shout out to Porzingis, though, because, I mean, you know, it's rough in those situations because those are high-pressure shots. And the fact that he was able to make the shot, I mean, I'm still happy because that says a lot about him. He's not afraid to take that shot. So you got to love that, you know, in your rookie, you know, who most people didn't even know who he was coming into the draft. And I have to say, I have been very impressed with him this season and what he's done. So I do like the shot. I'm glad he took it because, I mean, Melo's been struggling this season, you know, regardless. But you can't always count on Melo to make every shot to win every game. So you're going to need somebody else who could step in. I mean, Jordan had Kerr. He had Paxson in those guys. You know, Kobe and Shaq had Derek Fisher. So, you know, Big Shot Bob. You always need those other guys that can step in and make that big shot when it counts. He just has to really make sure he keeps his eye on the clock and he lets it roll off his fingertips before that buzzer goes off. If not, it's going to be another situation like this. But that does detail the New York Knickerbocker stat.
Yeah, I mean, but like you said, it's you kind of take somewhat of a win out of it. You can tell that he's not afraid to take those high-pressure situation, clutch situation shots and to hit a three-pointer with a hand in his face at the buzzer. Unfortunately, it's a microsecond too late, but it shows that we definitely got a good draft pick, despite all the fans that booed him. He's showing that Phil Jackson knew what he was doing by drafting him. He wasn't one of the big names out there. But even on draft day, you know, everyone was disappointed that they didn't get Okafor, but there really wasn't anyone left on that level. So this guy comes, an international player. He's not known because you didn't watch him. He didn't play in March Madness. He's not one of the high-profile names that was in the NCAA. So, you know, naturally the fans are going to boo because who is this guy? What is Phil Jackson doing? Phil Jackson's showing that he's smarter than a lot of the Knicks fans thought he was. But it leads to one of our fan mail questions. Philip from Queens writes in, the Knicks are 4-5 on the season and tied for 9th in the East. Is this where you thought they would be at this point in the season? I'm going to say no. I thought that they would be worse, actually, as the Knicks fan. But, you know, Porzingis came out looking good. Aaron Aufalo is finally back. He was injured in the missed the first few games of the season. This was his first game in the lineup in the regular season. So that's another addition to the many weapons that they have. And they're playing team basketball. Occasionally, Carmelo Anthony goes back to the isolation, but sometimes that works for him. I mean, when his shot is on, his shot is on. Yesterday, his shot happened to be on, actually. Mm-hmm. The other day against the Raptors, his shot was on. So they beat some tough teams. The Raptors won the division last year, and they beat them the game before Charlotte. They beat the Wizards in Washington. They beat the Bucks in Milwaukee. Those are all playoff teams from last year. So the Lakers was their other victory. But, I mean, anybody could beat the Lakers. I think if me and you got a couple of guys off the street,
we probably beat the Lakers.
As long as you give the ball to Kobe and let him throw up ridiculous shots with a hand in his face,
he'll
shoot 30% and we'll be good to go. But,
I agree with you on that stat, man. I didn't think that it's pretty good. They're in 9th place right now. You know, I didn't expect Melo to come out the gate shooting the lights out in the gym. You know, it's going to take him a little while because you still have to, you know, shake that rust off. He missed a lot of time last season. You go into, you know, to the summer, the training camp's coming back. So it's going to take him a little while before he can find that touch that, you know, we all know of Melo to have. You know, and I think that the guys are coming along. Galloway, I think he's been, playing really well for the Knicks. Like you said, Porzingis, nobody knew what Porzingis was capable of. And, you know, in the first place, everybody, you know, just, like you said, was upset with the whole Jahlil Okafor thing. And then it's like, well, you have no choice but to take Porzingis. I mean, you could take somebody. There's a couple of guys you could have took. But they picked Porzingis. Somebody read the scouting reports on him, you know, and it's looking like it's working out from this point on. We still got a whole lot left to the season, so I won't know where it's gonna go or how it's gonna end up, but I think right now it's working out. I mean, the Knicks, though, I will say this: they, if they're going to contend for a playoff spot, they have to win now, though. They can't wait until the second half of the season, and because you don't want to start getting that mentality where we're losing all of these games, and then it's harder to climb yourself out of that hole. Then you have Melo taking off another season because the Knicks are losing.
I mean, but they've been playing some tough competition. The teams that they're losing to are teams that, you know, that are pretty good teams, and they're not getting blown out in these situations, even against Cleveland. They play Cleveland again tomorrow night, so it's always great when the Cavs play the Knicks for myself and you our teams battling it out. Makes it a little bit more interesting with the trash talking when we're not on the air. So obviously the Cavs the better team, but it's always good when the Knicks manage to pull
first
up
first place
upset.
In the Eastern Conference right now, if I'm not mistaken.
It's going to be in the
no,
Garden
just saying,
as well.
Is that an accurate statement
game.
I just made right there? I'm asking you a question. Is that accurate, what I just said? You the stat man. Are the Cavs in first place in the Eastern Conference?
That is an accurate statement.
Oh, okay, all right. Just wanted to make sure me and you was on the same page with that one. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to, you know, put you on the spot like that, Stabby, but I just wanted to know.
But they do play tomorrow. But back to Porzingis, the rebound dunks that he's doing, it's just, you know, he's getting those highlight reels, just dunking over, posterizing people off the rebound, very aggressive. And, you know, one of the, you know, criticisms about Porzingis was how small he was. Like, you know, he's tall, but he's really skinny. He doesn't seem to have, like, you know, a big, bulky, you know, frame. Dwight Howard, you know, DeAndre Jordan or anything like that. But he's getting over these guys and dunking on them.
And I don't want to compare him to Kevin Garnett because he's not Kevin Garnett. But when Kevin Garnett came into the league, he had those same criticisms, you know. But he was still balling. And Porzingis is definitely still balling. I'm sure he'll wind up putting on a little more weight and bulking up a little bit.
Kevin Garnett started as a small forward, too. But,
you know, so I'm sure he'll wind up because it is going to be rough. If he's going to play that four position and you're talking about going up against guys like Aldridge, you got a guy, you know, Kevin Love, Blake, you know, these guys, you know, but you got to, you know, so he's probably going to put on a little bit. But, yo, I mean, he's doing 20 well.
He's 20 years old.
Yeah, he's young and he's doing well. I'm liking what I'm seeing from him. So, you know, I think it's working out.
All right. Well, there you have it. And other news around the NBA, Kevin Durant. Injured in the second half of his last game, out 7 to 10 days. But Russell Westbrook picked up the torch and kept it moving that game.
As
he just went, you know, lights out and put the, you know, hammer down and took care of business.
Another triple double. He's leading, you know, since last season, he's leading the league in triple doubles. I mean, what Russell Westbrook is doing right now, I mean, him, you know, and Stephen Curry, I mean, you could go either way. You could make a case for either one of them.
If he didn't have Kevin Durant on the team, he'd probably have better numbers than Steph Curry
definitely,
right now.
Yeah, he'd definitely have better numbers than Steph Curry. I mean, who do you take right now as the best point guard, though, as the better point guard, if you don't take either one of those, but Westbrook or Steph Curry?
I would still say Steph Curry just because he's not just a scoring machine. He's a great passer as well, so getting the rest of the team involved and everything. It's not like, you know, I said Russell Westbrook has Kevin Durant. If he didn't have him, he'd have more points because he'd be taking the workload. It's not like Steph Curry doesn't have other weapons. You know, Klay Thompson, Splash Brothers, they got, you know, he's got Green. He's got other weapons across the, you know, from the 1 to 5. So it's not like the rest of the team is a bunch of slouches and he's putting up ridiculous numbers right now. He's averaging almost a point per minute. He averages 31.9 points per game and 37.6 points for every 40 minutes. So that's almost a point per minute, which is phenomenal right now. And, you know, he's killing it. He's out there number one in the league right now in points per game. Second is James Harden. So
now, my only question with Steph Curry, because, you know, I think he's having a great season. And he's putting up these huge numbers, but I want to see, you know, when he's going up against the premier point guards in the league, if he's still putting up 35 a game against Russell Westbrook, against when Kyrie comes back, Tony Parker. I want to see if he's
Kyrie's not really a great defender.
Going to put up the, well, it's because it's more so about the back and forth thing. Because I noticed, that Stephen Curry, when there's a team that they're playing without a good point guard,
he's got to play defense.
Exactly. So when
out.
He plays deep, when he has to guard a point guard on the other end, that's when I really want to see. Because I know with Russell Westbrook, it doesn't matter who he's playing against. He can still put up those same numbers. So I want to see that from Stephen Curry when he goes head-to-head with the other elite point guards that are scorers. Because even, you know, Chris Paul, he could probably, because Chris Paul is not that scorer like that. He's more of a floor general and a facilitator. But when he goes against those top scoring point guards, I want to see how he fares when he has to guard and play, you know, play on the offensive end. So I really want to see that. But I still take Stephen Curry right now. I think he's the best in the league. But I got to see him against those elite scoring point guards and see what he does in those situations. And you can put up 40 against the Hornets and whatnot because they don't have a point guard that's going to score. So he really doesn't have to do work. But I want to see him against those teams that have those premier scoring point guards and see how he does if he still puts up those same numbers.
Well, the Warriors are undefeated right now. Who do you think is going to be the team to end that undefeated streak?
Well, I mean, the Brooklyn in me, I know I'm just jumping out the window here, but yeah, they do play the Nets in a couple of games. So I'm just going to throw that out there. The Brooklyn in me is going to
And you
to
say I'm biased with my Knicks, right?
Dude, that's just, but I'm front with it. I'm just being honest. You know, they do have the Nets covered up. Even, you know, the Nets did get their first win of the season.
I mean,
they beat the Rockets.
It was an impressive win considering it's against the Rockets.
You know, but
Rockets with Dwight Howard and James Harden.
But I got to say, there's a couple of teams that I feel like will definitely beat them. It's just when they play. I mean, I feel like the Spurs can beat them, to stop them. I mean, now Kevin Durant is out, so now it's going to be a little bit different, you know, if he comes back in time or not. Because I don't know what Kevin Durant was going on with these injuries now. It's like, you know, as the time continues, he's getting more of these little ticky-tack injuries, which I'm not liking. But I think OKC at home can definitely beat Golden State. That was the matchup, you know, I really wanted to see in the first round of the playoffs if Kevin Durant was able to come back and actually play. I mean, I feel like the Cavs can beat them. I feel like, I mean, there's a couple other teams that can stop them. But we got to wait and see. Like I said, I'm still going with Brooklyn. I'm going with Brooklyn. I'm just throwing that out there.
I mean, I think, well, they beat the Clippers at home, 112-108.
Yeah, they got the Clippers coming.
They got the Clippers coming up again
on
the road. So that, you know, might be the one that does it.
And that's, I believe, a couple of games after the Nets game. So
yeah,
if the Nets don't do it,
on the 19th,
maybe
so
the Clippers will do it if the Nets don't get the job done.
That's a week from today. And then the following day, they play at home against the Bulls. So
yeah,
he'll be guarding Chris Paul. Then he'll be guarding Derrick Rose, like you were talking before. I mean, it's hard to see anybody stopping them. They don't really have that much competition aside from those two games until Christmas Day when they play the Cavaliers, and you know the schedule makers definitely made a Christmas present for us on that one.
Yes,
that's
did.
The repeat of the finals.
That,
one
that
of the
Kyrie
two.
Kyrie will be back for that game. I really am, but honestly, I do feel like they can win that game without Kyrie playing, because I do feel like the Cavs did get better, and you know Kevin Love is healthy, so at least they have that 1-2 punch. But Mo Williams is playing really well for the Cavs right now. So I do think the Cavs can still get that win, but I would love to see Kyrie back in time for that game. Because that would really make Christmas great to see those two going at it. You know, because Kyrie said, you know, after the finals, he said things would have been different. Draymond Green had some words, you know, back and forth with him. So I really want to see that. I'm looking forward to seeing that game. But watch out for that Spurs game, too. I think that's going to be interesting.
Speaking of going at it and words going back and forth, we had DeMarcus Cousins cursing out Coach Carl. It seems like the feud continues between those two. What's your thoughts on it?
My thoughts are it's going to be Carl that goes because I can't see them trading one of the best big men in the game right now, somebody that can get you 25 and 11. I can't see
I mean,
see
it depends
them.
What you get for it, too. But at the same time, yeah. George Karl is not.
He's young.
He hasn't won a championship with any of his teams.
Yeah.
He won Coach of the Year a couple of years ago and then got fired by the Nuggets after winning Coach of the Year, I guess, because it was contract time. Yeah. He's a great coach. Going back to the Seattle Supersonics days, he's pretty much coached just about every team in the league.
Yeah,
because he's been floating around
the league.
But I mean,
I can't see them trading DeMarcus Cousins because of George Karl. One, you know, just because, like I said, he's young. A great big man. He's
the franchise player. There's
he's somebody you can build. You can build his team around. You know, coaches come a dime a dozen.
It's like if
Melo
and Fisher went at it. You know, chances are Fisher's the one that has to go. But
exactly.
It's just, you know, the players just don't respect coaches anymore. And we see a lot of, you know, we see coaches retiring because of it. But you know, and George Karl is one of those old school coaches. But definitely no respect. I mean, DeMarcus Cousins has a lot of issues aside from technical fouls, and he's pretty much beefing with everybody. So who's to say the next coach you bring in isn't going to have the same issue with DeMarcus Cousins? So is he more trouble than he's worth, or what do you think?
He's definitely worth a little bit of trouble. I mean, I would consider getting rid of George Karl. That's just me. You know, and what I would do is I would have DeMarcus Cousins help with the process of picking the next coach. That's what I would do, because if he is there, he can sit down and say, well, I'm cool with such and such. No, I don't like him. And then everything, you know, comes full circle and they bring in somebody that he's cool with. Then, you know, there's no excuses after that. Now you got to put up or shut up. So I think that would be the key. As much respect as I have for George Karl, he doesn't get along with DeMarcus Cousins. It's been going on for a while now, and I don't think that DeMarcus Cousins is going to change on this. And since he is your franchise player, I think that in this situation, you got to go with DeMarcus Cousins. Get rid of George Karl now before things get worse. You know what? It's early in the season. You don't want to wait too long, you know, because as long as they have that friction, I mean, there was, you know, a situation even where, you know, George Karl wanted to suspend him, actually, for, you know, cursing him out. But Vlade Divac stepped in and said no, he wasn't going to, you know, allow him to suspend him. So when you got that going on, I think it's, you know, inevitable that George Karl is going to be up out of there.
Do you think he makes it to the end of the season, though, right?
No, I can't say. It's just too much going on right now. He's cursing him out. Like, that just shows no respect for George Karl at all. They're not going to get along. I don't see it happening, so I wouldn't take the chance on just letting this thing linger. Like, let him go now, early in the season. You got time, you know.
I mean, they have some talent this year, too, so.
I mean, you got Rondo, Rudy Gay, and DeMarcus Cousins. Like, that's a really good three players right there, you know, three starters on your team. So I would say let's just, you know, and on top of that, Rondo didn't get along with him either. Rondo's, you know, another guy that doesn't do well with, you know, too many different coaches. But you got two players and two of your starters that have issues with him as the head coach. I think, you know, time to make that change now and just get it over with.
All right. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. One more fan mail question. We mentioned the Brooklyn Nets getting their first victory of the season. Paul from Brooklyn writes, the Nets finally got their first win. Do you think this is a sign of things to come, or is it just going to be a bad year for Brooklyn?
I mean, I just said they were going to, you know, be the team to stop the streak with the Golden State Warriors.
Yeah, sure.
But I
heard what you said, but
they're definitely in a rebuilding stage right now. You know, I'm glad they got rid of Darren Williams. He wasn't doing anything. Like, his best years were in Utah. I just don't think he ever really had it coming into Brooklyn, you know. And it was, while in Utah, you know, I was arguing whether or not he was better than Chris Paul, who was the number one, number two point guard in the league at the time, but it just never translated over to Brooklyn when he came to Brooklyn, you know. But you still have Brook Lopez, who's a very good center. He's still young. He's got a lot of years left, but they're going to have to, like, try to rebound and overhaul all of this stuff fast and get rid of Joe Johnson before the season is out. I mean, that was one of the contracts that really killed the Nets because of, you know, that
he's,
32
he's one of the
million.
Reasons why they won yesterday, though. But
I mean, but that contract, though, is stopping them from bringing in other pieces. So, I mean, he's old now at this point. He's not the same Joe Johnson he was even 2 years ago. You know, he's still decent. He can still, you know, do great things on a good team.
He has
a
good agent.
But on a team like this, he definitely has a good agent. But on a team like this Nets team,
Well, they dumped some cap too, I think, in that trade with Atlanta. So
yeah, they definitely.
You know, it wasn't just like we're gonna pick this up, you know. So it made sense at the time for the trade, but it's definitely the lingering contract now. But to answer Paul's question, yeah, I think it's gonna be a bad year for Brooklyn, just like last year.
Well, hold on, you know. It's never a bad year for Brooklyn. It's gonna be a bad year for the Nets.
Brooklyn Nets. I mean, the way he phrased the question was Brooklyn.
Yeah,
but,
it's never a bad year for Brooklyn. It's just a bad year for the Nets. All right.
100% agree with you on that one. But thanks to Paul and Philip for writing in. The email address is fanmail@realfansrealtalk.com. Our website, realfansrealtalk.com, for all individual contact information. You could also like us on Facebook, facebook.com/realfansrealtalk. Twitter and Instagram, @realfantalk. And, of course, all the information, once again, along with our archived episodes, all on our website, realfansrealtalk.com. Switching over to football, Rex Ryan comes back to New York with his Bills, and it's not looking good. The odds, well, for him, the odds of are 41% in favor of the Bills, 58% in favor of the Jets, and a 1% probability of a tie. Rex Ryan is 2-17 coming off of a victory since 2012. So he has, it's rare that he wins two games in a row. We saw that with the Jets a couple of years back. It's like they'd win one, then they'd lose one, then they'd win one, then they'd lose one. It just seems it's been a while for him to get two wins in a row. The Jets are at home. The Jets are a better team. The Jets have a better defense now. I think Rex Ryan comes.
And they just activated D. Milner, too. So that's definitely going to make that secondary even deadlier now that he's back. So, yeah, I don't think the Bills have a chance tonight. It's all Jets.
That is the Thursday night football game. The Jets have the first. If the playoffs were to start today, the Jets have the first wild card spot. And the Bills are on the outside looking in. But if they do win this game, they would take over that first wild card spot with the tiebreaker on the Jets. This is the first of their two meetings. Next month we'll have the Jets going up to Buffalo to face them in Buffalo. But I think the Jets are very capable of winning both matchups, but definitely tonight.
Yeah, no, they're going to win it. I mean, the Jets are a way better team. I'm really happy that Ryan Fitzpatrick wasn't out, you know, long term with that hand injury, because that would have been really sad for the Jets. That would have been messed up, because they're playing some great football this season. Like, they improved so many different areas this season. Like, you know, starting at the top, starting with the coaching, you know, improved with the coaching. The secondary is amazing, being able to bring back Revis. The line is shored up. You know, Chris Ivory is playing some great football. You know, you bring over Brandon Marshall to go alongside Eric Decker, and then, you know, you manage to bring in Ryan Fitzpatrick, who is a really, you know, he's a good quarterback, you know, but he didn't have any weapons in Buffalo, you know, or anywhere else for that matter. And now you bring him into a Jet situation where he has two really good wide receivers. He has a really good running back in Chris Ivory, and he has a pretty good offensive line. So, you know, he's able to do some big things with the Jets. We picked him early, you know, to do well this season, and they've been on pace to do what we said they were going to do. We knew that the Patriots were going to win the division, but we did pick the Jets to go to the playoffs and get one of those wild card spots, and they're living up to our predictions. You know, we got to start calling stuff like this more often. You know, we did say the Giants was going to win the division too, so that would definitely, you know, mean, you know, I mean, it sucks for the Eagles and for the Cowgirls and the Redskins, but when you know, franchises like those, I mean, does anybody really care?
Not really. You know, I mean, some people care, but I mean,
yeah, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, they're kind of like Mets fans where they're hopelessly thinking something's gonna happen.
That, man, you it's still fresh, man. The wound is still fresh. Don't pull a Band-Aid off just yet. You gotta let them go, man. Let them
I'll let the Mets fans rock for today. But moving along, Peyton Manning goes into Indianapolis and loses to Andrew Luck,
who is
no longer undefeated.
Who was now out for a month, by the way. He couldn't get injured before this game.
at least the job got done.
Yeah, the job definitely did get done, and Peyton's lackluster season finally caught up to him because the defense could not carry the load completely in this game. He needed a Peyton Manning-esque performance, and we did not see that. And the Broncos lost their first game as a result. And we mentioned that in order for Peyton to have a chance at winning a Super Bowl, it has to go through Colorado. They can't afford to lose these games, especially against – they should have beat the Colts, especially the way the defense has been playing. But, I mean, they just got no help at all from the running game, which, I mean, it's like they are regressing every week, you know. But they – so they go out there, they lose. That's going to be rough. The only thing that they have in their favor is that the Patriots play the Giants this week, and they haven't beat the Giants in, I think, it's about 8 years now. So that's the only thing that the Broncos have going for themselves right now. But they can't afford to lose any more games, you know, because Peyton's not going to do well if he has to go up to Foxborough and play. And, I don't see any reason why the route to Super Bowl isn't going to go through Foxborough at this time. Tom Brady is playing at an MVP pace. More than likely, he will be the MVP this season. You know, and the Patriots are just clicking right now. So I don't see why it won't happen. But like I said, he does have the luck of the Patriots coming to this side of town to play the Giants.
So obviously the Patriots are going to no longer be undefeated after this weekend. The other two undefeated teams, Carolina and the Bengals, they don't really have much competition here. They're playing the Texans for the Bengals, and then the Titans for the Panthers. So it looks like they stay undefeated for at least another week. The Bengals then play Arizona next week. I think that's where
the buck might stop there.
The Panthers don't have any real competition. They have the Redskins the following week. Then not until they play the Giants or the Falcons. They play the Falcons twice.
Yeah.
And they play the Giants once. The rest of their schedule looks like easy pickings for them. So I think the team that has the best chance of going undefeated is actually the Panthers.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. I mean, the defense is playing some great football right now. Cam Newton is looking well. He's running the football. He's passing the football. They're looking really good. The line has been holding up for them. You know, so, I mean, the Falcons have been struggling as of late. Devonta Freeman, he the last week or so, he hasn't been playing the way he had been playing. So I don't even know if they could beat the Panthers with the way that defense is playing.
Now, I mean, it would be great if the Giants beat the Patriots and then beat the Panthers and be like the streak breakers.
Yeah.
Like, that's what they're known for.
I'm all for that. You know, I'm all for that. But I would agree with you. I think the Panthers have the best chance of going undefeated this season. I don't think anybody is going to do it.
They just have an easier schedule than the
Patriots.
Yeah,
and that's the only reason why. But I don't think either team is going to do it. I feel like with the Panthers, it's going to be a team that we don't expect to beat them that's going to stop their streak.
Yeah.
The Patriots, we know that's going to be the Giants this coming Sunday. But and as far as the Bengals, I do agree with you. I think Arizona stops them. They're playing some great football. Chris Johnson has revived his career in Arizona. Being out in the desert, you know, it did something for him. He's turned things around, so you got to love that.
All right. And Joe from the Bronx wrote in, which quarterback would you rather have for starting for your team right now? Cam Newton or Russell Wilson?
I would still go with Russell Wilson, and they both have great defenses around them. I mean, I would give the edge to Seattle's defense, but it's something about, you know, winning a Super Bowl for me that, you know, kind of sets you above the curve. You know, he's been in that situation before. He knows how to win. And, it's possible we could have been talking about Russell, you know, Wilson being the two-time Super Bowl champion if Coach Pete lets Beast Mode run the football in, you know. So I would take Russell Wilson, but it's just that, you know, something for me, having that ability to get the job done in the Super Bowl, which is the biggest platform, you know, that's what does it. And, you know, and on top of that, he stays healthy. You know, Cam Newton, he's been banged up, quite a few times throughout his career. Russell Wilson, I don't think Russell Wilson's missed a game yet in his career. And on top of that, you know, he's winning right now. He got Sierra, you know, outside of football, so you got to love that, you know, even though they're doing the whole, you know, waiting, you know, until marriage thing, but, you know, that's neither here nor there. But, you know, I got to go with Russell Wilson on that.
Yeah, that's more, that subject's more for Ladybug and the Rudiman, which we'll have later on. But I'm going with Killer Cam, actually. I just think he's the better quarterback talent-wise. He does more with less. You know, Russell Wilson has beast mode, and he has the Legion of Boom defense, which is by far better than the Panthers' defense. Panthers have a great defense, but definitely not on the same level as the Seahawks. And, you know, Cam Newton, yeah, he just does more with less. He has less weapons, and, you know, he still gets the job done. Hasn't won a Super Bowl yet, but I think he's the more talented of the two quarterbacks. But I do see your point. I mean, Super Bowls go a long way. That's why I take Eli Manning in the playoffs over Peyton Manning, because he's a playoff quarterback, so which we've had that discussion numerous times. So thanks for Joe for writing in. Once again, fan mail at realfansrealtalk.com is the website. All the information is on our website, realfansrealtalk.com, for our individual contact information, archived episodes, social media, etc., all on one website, realfansrealtalk.com. Now, DraftKings and FanDuel have been in the news recently. Attorney General Eric Schneiderman ruled that it is illegal. They considered it gambling. They considered it luck, and they issued a cease and desist order. And you know, it even got mentioned in the presidential debate before that happened. You know, Jeb Bush was asked about it, and then Governor Christie said, "There's so many issues out here. Are we really talking about fantasy football?" But it's really not fantasy football, it's more gambling. So I see Chris Christie's point there, but it's still gambling, which is illegal. And the most interesting thing about this is on October 15th, the state of Nevada, pretty much the gambling capital of the world, banned DraftKings and FanDuel. They say it's more for taking advantage of the average fan and the more advanced fans. It's generally the 1% of people who keep winning over and over again, and the average fan is dumping the money in, and it's going to the same people. So, I mean, what's your take on DraftKings and FanDuel, Trip?
That point you just made right there actually does make a lot of sense, because, you know, the money does go to that percentage. But at the end of the day, I just think that, you know, if that's what the people want to do, if that's how they want to spend their money, you don't have to go on FanDuel, you don't have to go on DraftKings. So if you want to spend your money like that, if you know, if you want to smoke a cigarette, if you want, you know, if you want to have a little sip every now and then, you know, if that's what you want to do, that's what you want to do. Let them rock, man. Is it hurting anybody? You know what I mean?
I mean, it does hurt people. I mean, gambling hurts people. Gambling,
but you know,
is
that
an addiction.
Going in. You know that going in. That's,
yeah,
that's the issue. So if you know
when
it
you
going
say it
in,
doesn't hurt people, you see that with people gambling their money away affects the rest of the family when people are gambling their money away.
You
so
you should be a responsible adult
that's
and not gamble.
That's easier said than done for you know, those that gamble. But
listen,
I mean,
when I was a child, I thought as a child. When I became a man, I put away childish things. So if you know what it is, you understand. Listen, it's called gambling for a reason. You're taking a chance. If you don't want to lose that money,
I'm not against it. I'm just
feel bad for any adult who loses money gambling when you know that you're taking a risk going into it. So I can't have sympathy. So
you see it differently of an addiction than, let's say, drugs, or do you feel the same way with that? With hardcore drugs, cocaine, heroin.
Even with drug addiction,
to do it,
that's
and
still
I don't feel bad.
That doesn't mean that you don't deserve to have help. But at the end of the day, you know going in what's the end result?
Because gambling
to doing,
is an addiction
to doing
too.
It.
That's
yeah,
where
it's an addiction. But as long as you know, you were made aware of the possibilities and the outcomes that can happen. You can either win big, you can lose big, you can win small, you can lose small. But you know what's going on before you get into this thing. So as an adult, if you choose to do that, that's on you. And I say, hey, listen, let them rock. If that's what you want to do, let it go. I think what the real problem is they weren't making enough money off of it. So
no, I mean,
you know, They haven't found a way to...
The states that ban it, they see it as gambling, and they see people...
The states that ban it haven't found a way to make money off of
it. People kind of getting screwed. Now, I see it as, you know, the people who work for ESPN and stuff, they, you know, they talk about how they play it, and that they give advice on it. And
yeah.
You have, you know, the controversy that people who are working for FanDuel aren't allowed to gamble on FanDuel, but they're allowed to go on the competitors, DraftKings. So you have the controversy, class action lawsuit, because they have access to information, even, you know, the people's tendency. So if, you know, 30% of people are picking this player, they'll pick somebody that's not being picked by a lot of players. So, if only one, if only a half a percent,
they can't gamble on either one. Make it like that. If you work,
well, that's what they changed it to. But you see how, you know, this is just recent that they, you know, it was less than a month ago that they changed this policy. Now ESPN has access to information that the general public doesn't have. Like Andrew Wiggins was scratched 2 days ago.
Yeah,
you know, and it's like the average people don't know the game time decision.
Yeah, exactly.
They have him in their lineup, and then they're screwed because he gets 0 points.
Yeah.
And people who have an ESPN lineup will just
listen,
go and
you
do
got
that.
To, definitely, you have the edge in that regard, so I can understand that. You know,
I mean, it's definitely, you know, I could see the fun in it. Obviously, when you got a horse in the race, it's more interesting watching the sport and etc. and playing against friends. Like, you could do a one-on-one competitions against your friend, but it's illegal, so
that's why I only gamble on things I can control. I don't like betting on other people. I bet on myself. If I can't control the outcome, then I don't want to bet on it.
Understandable.
But let's can we jump over, because I want to sexy up the set a little bit, make it more beautiful on the show. Can we jump into the rumor mill with Ladybug right now? You know, we just talked the whole lot. I just want to bring Ladybug out onto the set and introduce her. You know, the people have been waiting. I've been waiting.
Special.
I know you got some stuff in store for us over there. Ladybug is in the building.
She does have a lot of fans from Real Fans Real Talk. It's like, shut up, guys. Bring her out already.
Like,
the live tweeting.
Enough is enough. We done got through the sports. Let's go. Let's get to the gossip so we can see Ladybug's pretty face.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Ladybug.
Welcome back. We missed
As
you.
As always, you know, I always have fun with you guys. Always great every week. And I'm definitely always glad to be here. So I'm just jump right into it. And I like this week's topic. It's more positive. And, you know, every time we have our final thoughts and things, everybody, you know, always say positive. I want positive outcomes. And this week's been very positive. It's the drama. You know, Ladybug got the drama. But it's a positive note. So, you know, definitely to start off, big shout outs to Marshawn Lynch. He definitely, you know, after, you know, they beat the Cowgirls, he definitely went to go see.
Oh, hold on, Ladybug, I got to stop you right there. Ladybug, I have to applaud you. She is officially one of us.
Ladybug, you're the real MVP.
Exactly. I love it. Oh, my goodness. Go ahead.
So, after they beat the Cowgirls, definitely Marshawn Lynch did like everybody else do after the game. They're hungry. So he goes into a McDonald's, and one of the employees, 17-year-old guy, complimented him on his shoes. It was like these designer shoes. And, you know, it attracted Lynch's attention. So basically, you know, he started a conversation just to see, you know, why he wanted to work, what was his purpose, and things like that. And his, you know, kid was like, hey, you know, I just want to make money for myself. I want to keep myself out the streets, and you know, things like that. So as the conversation went on, Marshawn Lynch really went in his pocket, took out $500 and was like, here you go, you know what, maybe I can help you buy these shoes and you could just continue on your way, because he was just so intrigued by this kid. And it's like, like I said, I really support athletes that like to give back and things like that, but to him to just walk into a random McDonald's, mind you, there's a McDonald's probably on every corner, and for him to just be in that one and just really take heed to just an individual and just a young man at that, because nowadays a lot of our young, you know, younger male need male figures, and for somebody to be an athlete and really take that time out and just really like was like, here you go, $500 in your pocket. Like, McDonald's is not paying you this.
Mm-hmm. Well, they were trying to go up to $15 an hour, wasn't it?
Definitely, that was something that was really, really commendable. So definitely shout out to Marshawn Lynch for that. So.
Anytime, Beast Mode, anytime you want to walk onto the Real Fans Real Talk set and come out your pocket $500 and buy me a pair of shoes, I'm all for that. I approve that. And you know what? So just whenever you're ready, just come on down. You know, I'll accept donations. It's all good.
I'll make sure that if I see Marshawn Lynch, to compliment him on the shoes.
Exactly. Everything. Yo, man, like the shoes. I like that shirt, man.
With the
shoes, it's hot. The watch, the chain, whatever you can, man. I just like it, man.
You styling today, Beast Mode.
Word. Compliments all around. But no, shout out to Marshawn Lynch.
I wish I had a wardrobe like that. You got $5,000 laying around.
Yeah, word. You know, could you help out? But that's definitely a good look for him. You know, I'm happy that he's doing that. You know, no cameras is around, so that's just him, you know, being a good dude. And, you know, I definitely applaud him on that.
Yeah, definitely. It's definitely something. And then even, you know, his family afterwards, they were like, how did he feel? He was like, you know, he was just really touched that, you know, he took this time out to talk to him. Because a lot of these kids, you know, they look up to these athletes. They you know, follow these athletes, you know, day in and day out, you know, also off the field, on the field, you know, wherever they play. And, you know, that's once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Yeah. You know, you don't see that every day. So that's just something I really had to bring up and commend. And another one that I had to commend, Ricardo Lockett, definitely, you know, he was injured recently. He had surgery on his neck.
Mm-hmm. And, done for the season.
Exactly. But after he got out of surgery and he was headed back home, and, you know, he actually seen this community basically feeding the homeless on the street. So what he ended up doing was he went to, like, I think, like, a local McDonald's or whatever was around and bought, like, 100 hamburgers and just came back and was giving it out to him. He had a neck brace on. You know, he was completely, you know, he was just still in recovery. Mm-hmm. And it was just, no, you know, still no cameras. It was nothing flashy. It was just him like, hey, you know what? I just feel like, you know, if I was him, my mind state would be, hey, my injury could have been so much worse. I couldn't have been here right now. Yeah. And probably was a reason for me to stop by and do this. And, you know, he just did it out of the kindness of his heart. So that's somebody else that I have to commend because, you know, like I said, you don't see these things every day. So definitely
shout out to the Seahawks.
That's
man.
What
the
I'm saying. They've been
doing it right now.
On
you
and off the
got
field.
To love
that's
it.
What
it
I'm
seems
saying.
To be all the generosity goes down to Mickey D's.
Yeah, I know, right?
They're really trying to get that 15.
I got a couple of calls mm-hmm. for the crew at Mickey D's. Do I get a shot? For my generosity, what do you think?
Shoot, listen, man, that's a beautiful thing. You know, do you think this is in connection with them beating the Cowgirls? Because both are coming after the Seahawks beat the Cowgirls. Does that have something to do with it? You just feel better about yourself when you beat up on the Cowgirls and you want to give back to your community, you know? So
You kind of feel bad a little bit because it's the Cowgirls and they're so pathetic. So then you feel like, did I really just do that? I just beat up on the Cowgirls.
Yeah,
I
see where you're going with that.
I got to go and do something nice.
Shout out to him as well. The Seahawks organization, man, those are two class acts right there. You really have to love it. You know, especially as much flack as Marshawn Lynch gets, for him to be, you know, to do that. And the same thing, like, coming off an injury. Like, he could be at home, woe is me. But, no, he's back out, you know, right after surgery. He's still in recovery, and he's out giving back. You got to love that. You know, you really do.
And like I said, you know, outside of him being an athlete, outside of him being in the public eye, that is just something, you know, as a human being we need to do. You don't need to be a celebrity. You don't need to be, you know, flashy and in front of all these cameras. Just that little, you know, you don't have to buy 100 hamburgers. You can buy one. You can give a piece of a burger. You can have whatever you have left. Like, you know, with everything being so expensive, a lot of, you know, you see so many people that are homeless and are unfortunate, and, you know, sometimes they don't even look like it, but, you know, you could tell it's just a lot of hunger in the world. So I definitely want to just shed light on that, because that can just start a movement and possibly, you know, in the long run, yeah, that's all.
Forward.
So definitely, you know, even though, like I said, I have good news, I always have the drama. It's always drama.
I was waiting, so I know some ratchet was going down this week in sports.
Something ratchet, and as always, you know, I have to deal with, I don't want to say as always, but Mr. Floyd Mayweather's always in something. I love the money team, don't get me wrong, but this man always, he knows how to draw a crowd, I guess. And once again, it's with Adrian Broner, which is another one that is just like, if it's not, I feel like if it's not one, it's the other.
So Floyd is having drama with baby Floyd. I don't know. Okay, let's see.
Like
what's
I said,
on.
If it's not one, it's the other. So now, basically, Adrian, you know, likes to get reckless at the mouth. And like I said, Mayweather does it too, but he's just like, you know, basically his words was, you know, blank the money team, blank Mayweather, blank all of them. So that was just, you know, that was...
Blankety blank, blank, blank.
Yeah,
blank,
if
blank,
you get
blank.
The gist.
Okay.
So, you know, Mayweather had to come back and say, you're the last one to say something because the money team done got you where you at right now. So after, you know, that was being said, he kind of, you know, regressed and was like, okay, he's right. So he tried to, you know, reach out to him, apologize, be a man about it. And Mayweather was just not returning that call. He was not answering the phone. He was being petty, as they call it, being very petty with Adrian. And basically now Adrian made a statement that he had to recant because, you know, he was just hitting the wrong buttons. You know how you just want to retaliate?
Yeah.
But you didn't think before you spoke. So basically, you know, His exact words, quote unquote, was towards Mayweather, stop being so gay. And then he had to, you know, when you think like, oh, shoot, I said it, then he's like, not that there's nothing, you know, anything wrong with it. But, you know, now he's getting the heat again off of, you know, everybody, you know, the LGBT and all these communities. Like, what does that mean now? What do you mean? So the beef just definitely opened up that floodgate to just Adrian just now being bashed because it's like, you know, you could have said stop being so petty. Yeah. There's so many other words he could have used, especially with, you know, awareness on everything. And it's not only about, you know, gay, lesbian, because I support everybody, no matter color, race, gender, whatever. But, you know, it's those choice of words because you are in the public eye.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a lot of, you know, communities that they definitely don't play that. Like, you say it no matter in what context. They're like, nope, this is not flying. You get the mail, you get the emails, you get the Twitters and everything. So it's one of those things where it's like, come on, Adrian.
I think the problem is that, you know, this is how a lot of people communicate in private. When I say in private, I mean away from the cameras. We might just be, you know, just sitting on the couch chopping it up, or you on the basketball court, or, you know, just wherever you at. So this is something that is just a natural thing that's been going on for a long time, to the point where, you know, now that you're in the public eye and you're in front of the camera the way you are, this is just how you're accustomed to speaking, so it's all natural, and you don't realize until after the fact. But you have to, when you get to that point, you really have to understand that every eye, every ear is on you. So you have to really be on point with that, because, you know, you slip up and them checks will stop coming. You know, they definitely will stop coming. So you have to be on point. And I understand,
the lawsuits will start coming.
Yeah,
that's what's gonna happen.
You know, he may not have meant that to offend anyone or any particular community, but it does still offend people, even if, you know, he wasn't. But that's just what it is, you know?
They have the commercials out there a while back, you know, that's so gay and et cetera.
It's yeah, like, NBA commercials.
You know, people are trying to mean it as you're being a sissy, but it's, you know, you shouldn't even say that in private. Like, you know, obviously, you know, you could just say sissy instead of you're being gay or whatever. Like, if that's, you know, the what he tried to mean by it, which
like
is most likely
petty,
what he meant,
petty,
but it's
like,
not.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or immature.
Or
like,
being
just
a little
said,
brutal,
yeah,
like, get
yeah,
over
yeah,
it,
yeah.
You know. But getting back to the initial, you know, controversy to begin with, to go after him, you know, just don't bite the hand that feeds you. And that's what he did. What
it was. But the beef is still going, so look out for that.
And Mayweather can talk because he backs it up.
Mayweather also talked about Ring Magazine, how Ronda Rousey was on the cover. So that beef continues, saying it's more a shot at Ring Magazine, saying that, you know, the Ring Magazine has been around since 1920, the golden age. That's, you know, boxing's magazine, and they put an MMA fighter, and he said a female fighter of a different sport on the cover. Yeah. And he's like, you know, boxing's, you know, going down the tubes or however.
It just tells how popular she is.
Yeah, but if you want to sell the magazines, that's the face. Mayweather's retired now, so, you know, that's the biggest name in fighting right now is Ronda Rousey.
Exactly, and talking about her, because I love her oh so much. I love her. Every time I talk about her, I'm like, oh, like,
sandwiches.
The girl crush, it's okay. Anyway, so, you know, talking about her making all this money and her appearing somewhere, you know, Mr. Sylvester Stallone himself, Mr. Rocky, told, you know, people that, you know, she's too rich for his blood. She's making all this money, and his budget is just not covering her. He literally was like, I can't afford her now. You know, she made an appearance in The Expendables 3, you know, and he does, you know, he loves her work, but she blew up in this year so much that he's just like, I'm on a budget and she's out of my league, quote unquote. So it's one of those things where it's like, you have to commend her. She's doing it. She's doing it the right way. And
she's
it's
doing
one
it
of
for
things.
The gram. You gotta love. She's 16-second knockouts, you know. So
and it's one of those things that, you know, like I said, I gotta commend her every time for, you know, for Rocky to say he can't afford you.
Yeah,
that's something big. So I can't wait to see who got this money and see what she's gonna do next. So.
He might have to open up the bank if he wants her back, you know. But we are running a little bit low on time, so I'm gonna jump into the final thoughts segment for the day, Ladybug. We're going to let you start it off, though.
Oh, but as always, you know, my reels are always fun. But like I said, I like this positive thought. 2015 almost over, 2016 is starting, so I'm just getting that ready. And definitely I'm ready to end 2015 with a bang.
That, man.
All right, since we're on the subject of Ronda Rousey, she's fighting Holly Holm this Saturday.
Yeah.
Also undefeated in Australia, should be a good fight. 16-1 favorite, but Holly Holm's pretty tough too, so I'm obviously Rousey's gonna win, I think.
Right, and I got two final thoughts. One, I gotta shout out the heavyweight champ of the world, Deontay Wilder, as he makes his return to Brooklyn. He's gonna be fighting at the Barclays Center in January, defending that belt, which, as you know, is a couple of blocks away. So maybe we'll be able to work something out on that account. And then secondly, good luck to the Brooklyn Mariners this weekend, and good luck to the Glen Cove Cardinals as they go on their championship quest. Win, and win big. With that being said, check us out on the web, realfansrealtalk.com, facebook.com/realfansrealtalk, Twitter, Instagram @realfantalk, youtube.com/realfansrealtalk. Follow us, man. We out here. We gonna keep doing it. You heard what they said in the beginning, Uncle Ralph. Video Music Box. We ain't going nowhere.
Fix your face. It ain't going nowhere.
Fix your face.
I say bet with your head, not with your hate, but just bet with your head. I'll make it short this time.
Let's go, Cavs.
Before
tomorrow.
So Ladybug, Trip Young, Mark the Statman, Skevich. We'll see you next week, everyone. Have a good night.
Good night.
Peace.
Real fans, realtalk.com. With Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Real fans, realtalk.com. Got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Is Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first.